Hello, and welcome to the second part of Upgrade Time, dedicated to Encounter Adventures. So, last week, I published this version on YouTube, and I got a bunch of feedback. So, most of the feedback was I was talking too much, this was too long, that was too dark in the background. I was looking too often on the side. The audio was not good. Quite a lot of many problems. So I try to solve some of it. As you can see, I switched the black thing in the background, so it's clearer behind. I changed the microphone, I moved the webcam on the center screen, and I reduced the resolution of my screen to mind-blowing 1024 by 720 or something. So, which means that now, in theory, when I run Auricutron, it should be big. And the source code should be much bigger as well. So last week I ended up here with just basically extracting the tape file into a text file that can be recompiled on the exit run. And this week we start part two by exact same file. The only difference that I renamed it to .baz instead of .txt so I can get a bit of syntax coloring. And I use the standard OSDK build files, which are here. So we have MechData, which at this point does not contain anything. So we'll add that later. Execute, which is just there to make it more practical to run. The build file, which has some custom command to convert the tape file to a disk. Which will allow us to continue to extend the game. And the config file, which does not contain anything special. So, last week we were done with that. So, this is the exact same game as last week. The main difference being now instead of a tape file, we have a disk file. It's the same size, it's just that the DSK file format is for the emulator and it contains the basic operating system and thing, but the game itself is still the same 31 kilobyte. And we can easily see that by running execute, which runs OSDK, Auricutron, sorry. We can see we are still with Encounter 2.0, press any key, we still have the exact same thing. What do you want to do now? North, etc., etc. If I do dir, I see that we have one file generated with a tape DSK on encounter.com, which is what the encounter tap file becomes when this function here is running. So far, so good. So, one of the things I very commonly do on the Ori game is, actually I made an article about that, is charset. What we have right now, it's the default charset of the Ori, which is not awesome. And here it's the same game, with only change being a type of medieval handwritten font. Here that one has a runic styling font. That one has some kind of slightly bold. It's a variant of the system font with just a small change here and there. And things are very, very simple. So basically, you just need to have the list of all characters, which you can easily extract from the system using the save command. And then you can just edit them. It's just 6 by 8 pixels. So, we are going to do that. So, generally what I do, and I already did it, is that let me find the font. So we have the mystery font. It's not a particularly awesome font, but it has the entire set of characters. These ones are numbers transformed as some kind of old style alarm clock. And the main difference is that they are slightly fatter and a bit more modern. The baseline is by having a different char set, your game stops looking like a standard worksheet. It looks more like a game. So now we have that, but we need to convert it to something. So for that, I'm cheating, I already did that, it's to avoid wasting time. And just to make Linux people happy, I'm going to make it correct. So by using pigconv, you can find the documentation here. So the default format is ORIC, so no need to specify it, but I did it in case of. U1, perform a date check on the files and only update if needed. This is not strictly necessary, but what it means is that if this file does not change, then the tap file, if it exists, is not regenerated, which is very practical if you have a lot of files you change regularly. And it's going to reconvert everything all the time. F0, it's the default format, which is, it does not handle any color change, it just assumes that it's a pure binary black and white output, which is perfect. On -01, which is tape format, simply the picture. So we have that. In theory, did I save? No, I did not save. I wish this window did not always disappear. So the font is not there. And it is not on disk. And the reason is I forgot to add it. You can see it's very well prepared. Now we have a font. So in theory, I could have specified a load address, but I did not. But if we go in the ORIC basic manual, we have the memory map, which is also available on the OSDK site in a slightly boring way or nicer looking way. So zero starts there and head of memory is here. And what we are interested by is this, which is the char set for the text mode. So what we need is that we know that it starts at B400, but the way it was done on the ORIC is kind of stupid. So if I do load it's kind of difficult. Yes. Font bin A B400, it's not going to load at the right place. I need to do plus 8 time 32. And now we have our big font. And you see why I use a PC text editor. It is very difficult to use a different keyboard and well. So that's pretty much it. So the reason is that B400 actually contains the 32 first characters, which are not printable. I don't even understand why they did that. It's totally stupid. So the first character that can be printed is space, and space ASCII code is 32. Each character is 8 byte long, and this is the way it works. So if we want this font in the game loaded automatically, we need to replicate that in our source code. So we add a new line, let's say 10, load font.bin a B400 plus 8 by 32. I could pre-calculate this address, it just does not matter. And if you wonder why the syntax is like that, you can go to defontforce.org and go to the URIC page. One day it's going to be in its own subsite, but right now it's not. There is an English version somewhere, I do believe. Load a program. Load file name. This A means the address. V is to some debugging option. This is to join. In case it's a basic program, you try to join with something else. Here with some example. So go back here. Encounter adventure, yay! We could also take the opportunity to use a font to draw some nice frames, a bit like in all those games, you know, where they were drawing boxes using a special Excel character. So I would not call that more readable, but it's definitely more looking like a game than it used to. There's still a lot of things to fix, like we still have the caps, we still have the stupid cursor. Bottom line is, now it's a bitmap, so you can change any pixel you want. So here, this pixel here is definitely square, and that one is definitely not nice either. So if we want to fix that. Not sure which one this was. Yeah, so we can see that the T now is nicely rounded. And the G as well. Oh, yeah, this F is really horrible. It should definitely be fixed. Could be also done like that, but then, let's say it this way. Not sure whether F. Your task is to find on rescue. Yeah, I think it looks better like that. We could also round here. Maybe the Y here should be a bit rounded on a young girl. Let's say Manu. No, that's nicer, like that. Yeah, the S is a bit squarey. Yeah, well, I think it's good enough. So another thing we could do is to replace this written description by a bitmap, and we could replace this by an actual nice intro picture. So we can try that. So we need. Help, what happened? That the prim when things appear on the wrong screen. So an auric picture is 200 by 200, and we are going to make a beautiful encounter 2.0. Could see the struggle to find the right location. PNG. Come here. This giant yellow box. Oh my god. We are going to call it title. So now we have this beautiful title. And we need to convert it as well. The main difference is that we are planning to get the title with some actual colors at some point. So I'm going to use a F6 mod, which is image to auric from SAM, which is able to generate some nice stuff. And to not be a total noob, let's add title tab here. So this time it takes a lot more time because the processing is heavy. There is even a progress bar for it. Run the program. We can see that we have title.bin. Yay! Beautiful. Now we need to get the game to load that automatically, which should not be very, very difficult. So this, all that is an intro sequence. And this is a menu. So what we can do is, let's see, since all that, I guess a press any key when you're ready is still something nice to have. But the first thing we need to do is to switch to iris mode. So iris load title.bin, command out this part. Press OK when you are ready. And you probably realize by then that I forgot something. The game is going to be very difficult to play like that. What I forgot is to go back to text mode. That's better. So this picture was kind of ugly. We can do a lot better. And I did some tests yesterday evening. It's not perfect, but it's an example of what could be done. So hello. Ah. So basically I started from the original tape inlay and I moved things around so it's possible to have the logo of the publisher on the name of the game. Now, yes, it's an Oric, so it's not going to look like that, but you can see. Yes, because it did not regenerate the title picture because of the optimization thing. There you go. So it's not fabulous, but I mean, it's probably more motivating to see that on startup than saying something like that. So there you go. That was the second phase. What I'm thinking for the next time is to have this thing here replace some by some actual graphics, as discussed in this article, which is about hybrid video modes, where you can do this kind of thing. But this is for another time. So hopefully the recording was understandable. It was not too long. Well, actually it's 23 minutes, so I guess not much better than last time. But then I guess since the show is called Upgrade Time, I guess it's going to be also upgrade, progressive upgrade for the show itself. So feedback is welcome. So hopefully next time can continue with the interesting thing. So have a good Sunday and have fun.